Students, once again I welcome all of you to PNP Cyrus Poonawalla, CBSC English Medium School, Nagaon, Alibag. We have already started the second lesson, Introduction to Current Education. Okay, so today we are taking second part of the same. Already we have seen computer memories. Okay, we have seen primary memory, secondary memory. Okay, we have seen RAM, SRAM, and read-only memory also. So today we are taking next part of the same. Understand more about microprocessors. Okay, we are going to check more about microprocessor. Do you know microprocessor means what? The microprocessor or CPU is the computer's brain and controls the entire working of a computer. Like we have brain, like that computer has got a chip. In every computer there is a chip which works like a brain of the computer. It is the CPU which performs all the arithmetical calculations and decision making operations on the data. The CPU processes the data according to a program or commands given to it and outputs the result. Now, structure of the CPU. First, let's understand this microprocessor. In a simple words, it is a CPU or central processing unit, CPU. Okay, this C stands for central, P is processing, U is unit. Okay, the area or the unit which processes or which completes all the processes is known as CPU. It's a complete computation engine that is fabricated on a single chip. On a small chip, it is fabricated. So it is very small, it is very, very powerful, that we all know. Let's understand the structure of a CPU. A microprocessor has three major subunits, which you can see here. Control unit is there, memory unit, or memory registers, arithmetic and logic unit, which is ALU, arithmetic and logic unit. Like whenever we type anything, it takes from here input to this CPU and output we can see on the monitor or a printer. On the monitor we can see the PowerPoint presentations which we are preparing with the help of keyboard and mouse. We can take printout of the same with the help of printer, so that is output unit. Okay, under the direction of the control unit, the program instructions and data are taken into the system memory, which is called as RAM, either directly from the user through input devices or from the secondary memory. Then one by one the instructions and data are moved into the internal memory registers in a proper sequence. The control unit informs the ALU of the precise arithmetic or logic operations to be performed and moves the data to the ALU. The ALU performs the calculation or comparison and returns the result to the memory registers. The control unit then transfers the result to a secondary memory device for storage or to an output device. So this is like a production unit wherein we produce some of the data with the help of all these three components or major units. Correct? So I hope you must have understood this is central processing unit. All the processes takes place here, whether it is a input command is there and the output commands or output data is there, is possible with the help of this unit called as central processing unit. Microprocessor manufacturers. We know that who prepares all this. Among all these, AMD is very, very popular. Intel is very popular for their quality. IBM is there. Texas Instruments are there. Motorola is there. Okay. So Intel Corporation is credited with the invention of the microprocessor. Intel, they have created or they have invented the microprocessor. and is the foremost in the world in developing and manufacturing microprocessors today. Other microprocessors manufacturers of repute are Advanced Micro Devices, that is AMD, International Business Machines, IBM, Xerox Corporation, Texas Instruments, that is TI, and Motorola. Okay, the models of microprocessors are labeled by codes, which are an assortment of numbers and letters. The first microprocessor brought out in 1971 was known as Intel 4004. Okay, since then the improvement is continuously going on, and we know nowadays the processors, they have become very speedy, fast, and that's why we just take the updated version of the computer so that we can complete our work with speed, efficiency. Okay, so now more about modern communication technologies. So there are various means by which we can communicate with each other. There was a time when there was only letter and there was some telegram. Okay, but nowadays there are various applications by which communication is possible. YouTube is there. On YouTube also you can chat, you can send videos. Okay, you can do live chatting also. Google Plus is there. You can send Google messages, means emails. Instagram is there, Snapchat, Twitter, and we know these are the popular one, Facebook and WhatsApp. Everybody knows WhatsApp. Okay, maybe you are watching the video on your WhatsApp. You must have received the video link. Okay, so these are all modern communication technologies. So let's see how the communication was when mobile came in our life. Okay, it was nothing but mobile SMS. Do you know the long form of SMS? SMS stands for short message service. Short message service means SMS. You might have seen these old mobiles, this SMS symbol. Nowadays we have smartphones, so SMS looks like this, correct? It is a technology that enables the sending and receiving of messages between two mobile phones. More recently, SMS is available on other wireless mobile devices such as handheld computers and personal digital assistant, that is PDA, okay, which is like a tablet phone. A mobile user types an SMS text message using the keypad of the mobile phone. Then he/she inputs the mobile phone number of the recipient and clicks a certain option on the screen, such as send or okay. Okay, so once you click on that, the message gets transmitted. On receiving the text message, the recipient mobile phone alerts the recipient user, who can read the SMS text message immediately or sometime later and reply if he she wants to. If the recipient phone is not switched on or is out of the coverage area, the SMS message will be stored in the SMS center and sent to the recipient as soon as the phone is switched on. So this is all about SMS, we all know, which was similar to WhatsApp only. But in WhatsApp, we can send the similar message to many people. We can send media as well, means video, audio as well. But SMS had some limitations. But at that time, it was really very, very useful and popular. Okay, so that time it used to contain very limited data, at most 140 bytes or 1120 bits. Okay, so one SMS message can contain up to 160 characters in English. Characters means words. An SMS text message in an international language such as Hindi, Arabic, Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Russian can contain only up to 70 characters, because it uses 16-bit Unicode encoding. Okay, it's used 16-bit Unicode encoding. Beside text, SMS messages can also carry binary data such as ringtones, simple graphics, operator logos, wallpapers, animations, and business cards. However, an SMS message cannot include rich media content such as pictures, animations, and melodies. Okay, so it had some limitations, but at that time it was one of the very, very popular medium of messaging or communication. So let's understand why SMS was very popular all over the world. Okay, that was the time when enormous number of SMS messages were exchanged or used to exchange every day. So let's find some of the reasons behind the success of SMS. So first one is reliable and cheap means of communication. So SMS is a reliable and cheap means of communication for concise information. Suppose you want to send a message to your friend, we will meet at 12:30 p.m. near the school ground. So at that time it is really going to be very useful because you need not to think much. You have to just type and you have to send it to your friend. He'll receive it and he may send you the reply, or he will get your message instantly. So you need not to go there, you need not to do anything else. Okay, second is message can be sent to multiple recipient. The same message can be sent to many others also. Like I have sent a message to one of my friend and I want to send the same to others as well. Like I have sent a message to my friend regarding my birthday celebration. Okay, I have arranged or I'm planning to arrange a party. So I have sent a message to one of my friend. The similar message can be sent to others as well. Correct. So it's really good that we can send the message to multiple people or recipients. Next, can be sent and read at any time. You can send the message anytime. Whenever you'll have mobile phone, you can just type and you can send it to anyone. And at the same time, suppose you are busy, you have received somebody's message, so there is no time limitation or there is no expiry to that message. You can read at any time as per your convenience. You can do the same. Can be sent to an offline mobile phone. The message can be sent to an offline mobile phone. You can send it to any offline mobile phone. Nowadays, like suppose I have to send you WhatsApp message, but for that you need to have data connection, active data connection. Okay, if there is no data range, you won't receive or you won't send any message to anyone. So that is the limitation. But in case of SMS, it was a offline mode application. So it is less disturbing to the recipient. Okay, SMS messages are less disturbing because they doesn't make any loud noise or they don't take so much memory of your phone, so they are less disturbing. Okay, like we know that nowadays on our mobile phone in WhatsApp we receive so many messages, some of them they are not useful for us, still we receive them. Good morning, good night, and all types of messages. Sometimes useless medias like videos and all that we receive from our family members and friends, okay, which takes so much memory of mobile phone, and because of that sometimes we get frustrated. What is happening all this, why there are so messages? But in SMS people used to send the important things only, so it was less disturbing to the recipient. SMS messages can be exchanged between different service providers. Like I'm using Jio phone and you are using Idea. Okay, your SIM card is of Idea company, then also I can send SMS to you. So there wasn't any service charge or like that. Okay, so this is what, or these are the reasons why SMS was successful when it was started or when it was launched. Now example of SMS application. what are the examples of SMS applications? So it's a person to person text messaging. You can send a message to that particular person, and this is the most commonly used SMS application, and it is what the SMS technology was originally designed for. This SMS technology was designed for person to person text messaging, so that we can send it to that particular person only. Next was provision of downloading and receiving information and alerts. Okay, so there was a provision of downloading and receiving information and alerts. For a certain small fee, a mobile user can request for information services like news, weather, report and financial data. Download services like ringtones, wallpapers and alerts. Okay, so it was all possible. And last was as a marketing tool. Nowadays also WhatsApp and Facebook is used as a marketing tool. So at that time a company may send messages. At that time the company used to send messages about the latest discounts and products, sale, okay, new stock and various other happenings in the market. Okay, so this was altogether very very useful. Now next, after SMS there was an upgradation to it, that was MMS. So here with the help of these pictures you can easily understand the difference. In this picture you can see only text messages are there, but here the view was amazing, superb like that. But here we can show in MMS we can send videos, short videos as well as pictures also. Okay, so MMS means it's a multimedia messaging service. It is a communication technology that allows mobile subscribers to exchange multimedia messages with other mobile subscribers. Like nowadays with the help of WhatsApp you can easily send video messages, video lectures. Okay, so at that time with the help of MMS it was possible to send pictures, audio, text, video and combination of these. And multimedia message can be created either using a built-in camera or images and sound stored previously in the phone. Okay, so it was altogether very very useful. Okay, so next application was mobile roaming mode. It's a not an application but it's an option. Like we know that every thing has its own limitation or a boundary. Like that only when service provider provides you a service, they have their boundaries. Okay, so if you want to go beyond those boundaries you need to use network of other service providers, so that is called as mobile roaming. So you need to turn mobile roaming mode on and you need to have a special recharge for the same. Like here a dash person has crossed the boundary, so he has received the message: welcome to France, your roaming cost are outgoing calls, cost 24 paisa per minute and 6.6 paisa per minute to receive outgoing SMS. Okay, so here he has received. Like that only once you cross the boundary you also receive particular types of messages. So when you subscribe for a mobile phone service with a provider vendor, your place of registration defines your home network or home area. Depending on your rate plan and service provider, your home area can be a city, a geographic region, a state or a multi-state area. If you use your phone outside this home area, you are said to be roaming. All phones have some visual display to let you know that you are no longer in your home area. Here you can see they have shown R. R means roaming. You are out of your home network area. And for nowadays as we use internet on our mobile, so for mobile data also there is a roaming. So we have to just make it on, then only we'll receive data. Okay, 4G, 3G, whatever data plan you have purchased, you can see here. Here it is showing H. H means high speed data. To stay connected when you roam, you must additionally subscribe for roaming mode with your service provider. When you roam, airtime rates are typically much higher than your plan rate, and you may even be getting your service from different service provider. And when you use your mobile out of your home network area, you need to pay some extra money or extra charges, because sometimes you need to use the networks of other service providers as well. Okay, so this is all about mobile roaming mode. I hope you have understood this. And today we have completed some of the important points regarding modern communication technologies. We'll complete the remaining points next time. Okay, until then, thank you so much. Bye bye. In homework, you have to write short notes on SMS, MMS, and mobile roaming mode. Only three. Okay, you have to write short notes on them, nothing else. So thank you so much for listening so patiently and watching.